All right, time to check to see which of the props from last week's video I'm gonna be shooting with. So thank you to everybody who voted. And drum roll please, we are shooting with, oh, so close. A lot of you went for the big scoop, but not as many of you as went for the small copper dishes. So what should we do with the copper dishes? What would work? I have this idea, and I've never actually shot this before, but I've always wanted to, and I bet I can find a good recipe online, probably New York Times, somebody like that, for shakshuka. Is that how you say it? I don't want to screw it up. It's like an egg dish with a tomato sauce, and we could put them like in each of the individuals and then bake them off. I think that would look really, that'd be some really fun colors. All right, sure enough, we've got shakshuka with feta from Melissa Clark. Their recipes always work. I love the New York Times for recipes. See, got the idea? So they're doing like this metal bowl, but what if we did them in the individual? So each individual one has sauce and peppers and an egg. Be so cute and get some like crusty bread going on. Okay, the idea is percolating.
So now that I know what I'm cooking and I know what I'm serving it in, now it's time to do a little image research. This is where I get kind of those creative juices flowing. So what I want to do is check out online just some general images of shakshuka so that I get a good idea of how people are styling it. Now obviously for the most part they're doing it with the multiple eggs in a larger dish, but I'll still get some really good ideas from this. And then too, I'm also looking at images of tarts, thinking that like small little tarts that a lot of people are doing multiples of those, and that's really something I want to capitalize on in this image because I have so many of those little copper dishes. I want multiples of them in the image. Now looking through these images, there's definitely a lot of overhead shots. And you know, part of me is always thinking, I want to do something different. I don't want to do what everybody else has done. But one thing that I'm really seeing a lot of here in these images that I really like is how they're taking, especially when there's multiple tarts or multiple different items, that they're containing those, again, with a tray like we talked about in last week's video, or with like a cutting board, something just to delineate and help to organize those multiples so they don't feel like they're kind of floating around, to really give them some boundaries to work with, to frame them. And it just so happens that this absolutely gorgeous cutting board that I bought online, I bought it through Etsy, it came from France. It kind of costs a lot of money, but it was well worth it because to me this is one of those beautiful staple pieces, something that I can use time and again. It's so flexible, it's so versatile, and so I'm super thrilled to have it. And I just thought the overhead shot would show off the beauty of this board. I mean, this is like a really well-aged board with all those cuts and gouges and just like a lot of history in it. And so to me, the overhead was gonna be the best way to go for this. I also wanna pull some other props that I think are gonna go well with it. So we've got those little dishes. I've also pulled, of course, that really nice board. I got some forks that I thought would work really nice with this. They're sort of simple and clean lines. I got these at an antique store. And then we also have this beautiful linen napkin. And this particular napkin, it's linen. And I got it from a houseware store in California. I looked up the brand, it's by Caravan Linen. I'll link them as well as like all the other stuff in this video down below so you can go check them out. I really like this linen because it's just heavier, it has a lot more weight to it, it holds its shape and form, and the size of the napkin is big enough so that I can get a couple folds out of it. You know, when you're working with a napkin that's just too small, it leaves a bit to be desired. And the surface that I'm shooting with here today is one of my personal favorites. It is a newer addition to the collection, and it's from Erickson Surfaces. I've talked about them here on the channel before. This was a custom board that I created directly with Jenny over at Erickson Surfaces and told her, you know, I was looking for something that was warmer toned, that had a little bit of like tan and taupe in there with a good bit of texture, but nothing too crazy, definitely kind of more of a plaster look. And you know, as per usual, Jenny absolutely nailed it. So I've been having a lot of fun with this board. If you find yourself over at ericksonsurfaces.com, I do have a discount code for 10% off at checkout. That's BiteShot10 for 10% off. So before I start cooking, what I really want to do is I just want to dial in the setup, make sure I understand what I'm going for in terms of the lighting, that all the props work together, kind of get it set up, and so that then when I have cooked the food and I introduce the hero, that I've pretty much got everything in place. So today I am shooting with the 5D Mark IV and my favorite go-to lens that I shoot with these days, I mean probably 85 to 90% of the time, is the 24 to 70 mm millimeter f2.8 lens. And then in terms of the lighting, this has been my go-to setup for maybe the last, 4 to 6 weeks. I was doing a test shoot and kind of playing around with two light setups, and I really liked where I landed with this. And so I've been using this a whole lot. It's very versatile. Between the two lights, they kind of go back and forth between which one is the key and which one is the fill. If these are sort of foreign terms to you and you want to learn more about artificial light, I do have an online course, Artificial Academy. You can check that out below. But for this particular composition, I want the light entering from the top of the frame, at least that key light entering from the top of the frame. We talk about this in the overhead flat lay video. If you missed that, you can go grab that. I think that looks really natural when the light enters from the top of the frame or up from the corner of the top of the frame. It just makes a lot more sense and feels balanced to our eyes. So I have the one Godox 8600 Pro. It's got a 7-inch reflector on it and a 60-degree grid, and I am bouncing that off of this large background, which is just a neutral colored white background that I use as sort of like a backdrop from time to time on my, you know, head-on shots or three-quarter shots. But in this case, I'm using it to bounce that light off of so that I get a really nice soft but with a certain amount of intensity because of how close I have that light to that background. So it's just giving me that natural light feel that I'm looking for. And then the second light is behind the Roscoe diffusion material. It's kind of up towards the top of the frame and sort of angled. It's not shooting straight through that Roscoe diffusion. It's kind of coming in at an angle and sort of skimming it. And I'm using that for my fill light. And then you can see I've got the camera mounted overhead on the C-stand, which is definitely a go-to setup for me. A lot of people have questions about the C-stand. If you want to know how I rig that all up and how that works, all the parts and pieces, I've got a video all about it. But by no means is that like the only way to mount a camera overhead. There's all sorts of different ways and methods. Skylar over at We Eat Together also has a great video, another different option for mounting overhead. There's a lot of options out there, just like in the world of photography. So I'm using the C-stand today. And then next is one of my favorite parts of the creative process of creating an image, is just playing around with the props, like messing around with the napkins, getting that right fold, getting the positions. And granted, you don't totally 100% know how things are gonna look until the food is introduced, but we can get a pretty good sense by moving things around and really looking for those lines. Again, if you're needing help in terms of composition, I'm referring a lot of old videos in today's video. This is like supposed to be like some sort of culminating video. If you need help with your composition, I have a whole series. You can definitely go check that out. But I'm just playing with the lines and the shapes and the connectedness of this image. One of the things that I think is interesting about this, we talk about the rule of odds. And so the rule of odds would dictate that I should have 3 or 5 little dishes, but there was something in me in this image that I was like, no, I just really like the way that 4 looks. So just like I always say here, and just like you hopefully well know, is that rules are meant to be broken. And if something feels right to you, and if you like the way it looks and that it's working for you, then go for it. Now, I did take one creative liberty with the recipe from the New York Times. It's a phenomenal recipe, super delicious. We ended up eating it for dinner that night. But one thing that I did end up changing was that it recommended to garnish with cilantro, but I garnished it instead with flat leaf parsley. And the reason being, I mean, I love me some cilantro, and not everybody loves cilantro. I'm a big fan, but the problem is that cilantro is so delicate. And if you've worked with it before, you know that it just wilts so quickly that you don't have a lot of time to, you know, play with and change your composition. I mean, if you do that, and if you're working with a dish and you're shooting it over a certain duration and there's cilantro on it, you're gonna be wanting to swap out that cilantro to keep it fresh. And that just was more work than I was up for in this particular shoot. And I didn't think you would mind. So instead I went for the flat leaf parsley, which really holds its form nicely. It stays perky and fresh longer. It doesn't get all wilty and brown. So I mean, we went with parsley. So then once I captured that hero shot, something that, you know, we love to do, right? If we've done all this work and we've created this beautiful dish, let's go ahead and get some different angles. Let's get some different orientations going here. So I got that horizontal thumbnail shot. I mean, the purpose of this image was to create a thumbnail for this video. So I'd say mission accomplished. And so then what I did is I wanted to get a vertical, right? So that we could have it for the Instagram. So then at that point, what I'll generally do is I will change the angle of the camera so that that I can keep the lighting the same, that the light's still entering from the top of the frame, even though now we're going at a vertical orientation. And then generally I'll pull a lot of the items away and then reset them into the scene so that I'm creating the composition that's balanced based on that new angle or orientation. But then story of my life, something that I'm sure has happened to you too, as I'm clearing the scene and it's like, okay, I got all my shots, I feel good about this. And then I had this like old busted baking tray, which I've used in photographs before because it's got a lot of really great character to it. It's old, it's beat up, it's got a lot of patina and color and character. And so then I stuck the shakshuka, like the little dishes, onto that tray and I was like, oh gosh, that's really beautiful. It's like it was just pulled out of the oven, right? Let's go ahead and get one more shot. So sure enough, set things up, got a couple more shots of just those on that surface and oh, love these too. It's hard to say which ones I love better. I think I love them all, but it's definitely a different take on it. But it's just always that wonderful reminder that I love so much about the creative process is just because the shoot is over doesn't mean that that's your last shot. And to always keep your eyes peeled because there's a lot of beauty in the cleaning up. So I'm hoping this video gave you some insight into my creative process, what goes on in this crazy brain of mine, and gave you some new ideas for the next shoot that you're gonna do. But in the meantime, we'll be back next week with a new video all about working with fake ice. I cannot wait. It includes a bunch of interviews and there's gonna be a giveaway. So definitely, if you're not already, be sure to hit that subscribe button. You stay out of trouble and I'll see you soon, okay? Bye.